3 minutes till airtime. Almighty God, I ask, as we prepare to go on the air, I ask in your mercy that you would quicken the word that is to be spoken. I pray for those who are joining me on video, and I ask, Lord, that their hearts would also be quickened. Quickened to pray for those across the city who are going to be listening. Lord, I pray that your word will go forth with power today. I pray that there will be no distractions, and that your spirit will do a deep work of conviction, opening men and women's, boys and girls' hearts to just unreservedly and heartily give themselves over to you, Jesus. I thank you for the opportunity to share your word. Lord, I know that either this must grow up in revival out of your Holy Spirit, or it's not going to happen because in my flesh I can't make it happen. I just lift up your name, Jesus, and I praise you today and worship you. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Have you taken up the pilgrim journey toward heaven? It's not an issue I need to emotionalize. It's not an issue I need to get all excited about. It's a very straightforward, very honest question. Have you set out in your life on pilgrimage toward heaven? Yesterday on the 30th of May, I interviewed on this broadcast a dear brother, David Sampson. In very unemotional terms, he laid out the inner workings of the Holy Spirit in his life as he transitioned him from utter darkness into the glorious light of Jesus. He opened for us very profound and deep understanding of what it means to set out on pilgrimage and to allow the Holy Spirit to come and baptize or crucify every part of the life that was produced by the flesh. Now, if we consider that for a moment, almost everything that most Christians produce and most churches produce is simply out of the flesh. The book of Matthew tells us that everything of the flesh will be uprooted and cast into the fire at the end of time. It's only what is birthed out of the Spirit that will matter. Part of what David Sampson opened for all of us yesterday was that it is that which is birthed out of the Spirit in our job. It's that which is birthed out of the Spirit to bring us a wife or a husband, children. It is birthed out of the Spirit so that everything that's growing in our life, our finances, all of our plans, every activity, it all grows up out of the Holy Spirit. I spoke with a man this morning. Well, in fact, I'll just tell you quickly what happened. I stopped by a commercial place of business because I needed to just make contact. So I went in, and this dear brother was there. And his first statement to me was what Jesus was doing in the ministry of the Gideons, of which he is a part. I listened to his testimony, and then he quickly turned it back and said, "What's happening with the radio broadcast?" So I shared with him some of the responses and the word that's being spoken and David Sampson's word from yesterday. And he was moved on by the Holy Spirit, and he said to me, "Come out to the car with me. I need to get my billfold. I'm going to open my billfold, and whatever is in that billfold, I'm going to give you for radio." I said, "Is the Holy Spirit telling you?" "Yes." "All right, I'll walk with you." Walked out to his car, and he did just that. He opened his billfold, and he took out a whole handful of bills. He handed them to me and said, "Please put this on radio." We prayed and we fellowshiped together. And then I was looking at his Jeep. It's an older Jeep, but in excellent condition. And I said, "Your Jeep looks like it's new." He said, "Well, I just lost my air conditioning." I said, "Are you going to replace it?" He said, "Well, here's the problem. They want between $1,600 and $1,700 to replace the air conditioning unit." I said, "Well, are you going to do it? Because this is his ministry vehicle." And he said to me, "Pastor, I don't spend $1,600 without going into serious prayer, because I know I need the Holy Spirit's direction, because I don't want to do anything that is not out of the Holy Spirit's desire and out of his orders." As I listened to Tom give that testimony, my heart was just stirred. This is what David Sampson was talking about yesterday. Not just going blithely along, "Oh, the air conditioning's out on the Jeep, let's get it repaired. This happens, let's take care of it." No, it's come back to the prayer closet. It's pray through. We only want to have happen in our lives what the Holy Spirit is prompting and what he is directing. I know this radio broadcast. I come here by faith. And I say, "Lord, this radio broadcast is growing up out of your Spirit. I don't need to do anything in the flesh. It's of your Spirit. And because it's of your Spirit, I know you'll move in it and convict people of their sin, and you'll cause them to begin this pilgrim journey. Or you will encourage them on this pilgrim journey. And you will bring them safely to the celestial city." I invite you to go to our webpage, nationalprayerchapel.com, and there you'll find the May 30 broadcast, and I encourage you to listen and watch that video as David Sampson talks through these inner workings of the Holy Spirit in the life of those who set their heart on pilgrimage. It literally means everything that was in my life when I began the pilgrimage has to be taken to the cross and has to be brought through that narrow door. That nothing in the life of a Christian is taken for granted. Not my work, not my wife or husband, not my children. All has to go to the cross. And then only that which grows up at the direction of the Spirit is going to bear any fruit for eternity. See, my concern in coming to this broadcast is that we bear much fruit. I didn't come to do this broadcast not to have an overwhelming response. Just the opposite. I came because the Lord God of heaven is calling for revival in Washington, D.C. And revival doesn't come in any way except by way of repentance, by a man turning from his wicked ways, from a man turning away from the work of the flesh, and only focusing on the work of the Spirit, whether it be in his job, his family, in his health. We only desire that which is birthed of the Spirit, and then we come with Jesus and say, how would I be able to help you, Jesus? How could I be of service to you, Jesus? In this work of the Spirit, my body is available. I've moved out of my life. My life now belongs to you. It doesn't belong to me. My life is yours. My family is yours. My time is yours. My money is yours. My car, everything I have is of you, Jesus. And then we're desirous of the Lord growing up. Now, we spoke yesterday also about the difference between mechanical and organic. Mechanical is like an automobile works. The air conditioning goes out, you drive in, they take the dryers out, they take the whole unit out of the car, and they replace it. And then you get in your car and you turn on the air conditioning and that cool air blows. And you say thank you very much as you drive away with your $1,300 $1,500 bill. Well, in the Spirit, it doesn't work that way. In the Spirit, it's organic. As David said yesterday, it grows like grass, except sometimes a little slower. As you walk with integrity before God, as you don't initiate your own plans, as you don't reach out and grab in your ambition, you simply wait on God, and you read the Word, and you fast, and you pray, and you walk in the classic Christian disciplines, that is, those things that create discipleship. You turn the television off. You turn the whatever it is that drains away the Spirit in your life, you turn it off. You leave it alone. You don't go down to Georgetown or some other pleasant place to party at a club or to go to a bar. You leave the sporting activities alone. You turn aside and you begin to seek after Jesus with all of your heart. And as you do this and you begin to walk in integrity before God, as you take those baby steps toward heaven, the Father comes and meets you. Jesus meets you. The Holy Spirit meets you. And a new life begins to grow up in your heart. It takes time. I was raised on a farm. I would plant the row after row of corn, either with the corn planter behind the tractor, or sometimes Dad would just say, "Come on, Ray, let's plant some corn." Usually it was the corn we wanted to come up either very early or very late. And he'd get his shovel and he'd go out in the plowed field and he'd put that shovel down, he'd pull back, and I'd throw three seeds into that place where the shovel had made a hole. He'd pull the shovel out and it would be buried, and we'd go to the next and the next and the next. We'd plant a whole field of corn that way. Well, I would go out the next day to check to see if it had grown, and when it happened, I'd dig down to find a seed. And I'd go back and tell Dad, the seed's dead. Nothing's happening. Nothing's happening. And Dad would laugh and he'd say, no, Ray, leave the seed there. Go put it back. Just wait a little bit. And one day we'd see the crows out in the field. And Dad would say, well, we better get out there and scare those crows out of the way. And quite frankly, he'd take a firearm and take the crows out because they were eating our food. And sure enough, the corn was just sprouting up through the ground, and the crows would jerk on that piece of corn and pull the seed up, and they would eat the seed and destroy the corn. Well, that's organic. You don't need to go dig up what God's doing. You need to trust him. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Read the word. Fast and pray. Not give way to tobacco. Not give way to drinking. Not give way to drugging, not give way to lust or pornography or fornication or adultery. Not give way to anger or bitterness. Stay quiet before God. He's growing righteousness in your soul. This takes time. Take time to be holy. Our phone number here in the studio is 877-534-0780. I'm going to have our Mr. Producer play this piece of music for us. It's an old, old song. I woke up singing it yesterday. Take time to be holy. And after that piece of music, if none of you have called, and that'd be all right, I'm going to share with you more of the account of Christiana, the wife of Christian, as she takes up the pilgrim life. Let's listen. Take time to be holy.
Friends of God's children,
Take time to be holy, the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. Have you taken time to be holy? To allow God to do this organic work in your life where you just turn off everything that drains away the life of the Spirit from your heart? Television, novels, clubs, they all drain the Spirit from your heart. You can't be a serious Christian and walk in the ways of this world. Jesus said, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. You can't follow Jesus and take along all the things of this world. You can't do it. Have you set out yet on this pilgrim journey? Let me share with you the story of Christiana. By the way, my name is Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. We're streaming live at nationalprayerchapel.com. That's nationalprayerchapel.com, one word. Or you're welcome to call me at 703-672-1203. If I don't answer, leave a message and I will get back to you. That's 703-672-1203. Concerning Christiana, for that became her name from the day she and her children took up a pilgrim's life. After her husband had gone over the river, she could hear from him no more, and her thoughts began to work upon her mind. The first reason for it was that she'd lost her husband, and the loving bond of that relationship had been utterly broken between them. Nature can do no less than entertain the living with many heavy reflections in the remembrance of the loss of that loved one. These reflections on her husband therefore cost her many tears. But that was not all. For Christiana herself began to consider whether her unbecoming behavior toward her husband was one reason why she saw him no more, and for which he was taken away from her. I want to stop a moment. How are you treating your husband? How are you treating your wife? If they were to pass, would you have bitter memories, regrets? When we begin this pilgrim life, one of the first things that begins to happen is conviction begins to flow in that we're not treating our family the way Jesus would treat them. We're not treating our workmates the way Jesus would treat them. To be honest with you, most men have real anger hidden away in their soul. In America, men have been so pushed in a corner and so feminized. The church, frankly, has been so feminized that a lot of anger results. And it's shoved down, and it pops up at the most inopportune time. I'd love to have women come to the National Prayer Chapel. But when I was told by the Lord to found the National Prayer Chapel, I said, Lord, there are two things that I need to be clear with you about if I'm to do this. I don't mean to bargain with you, Lord, but these are just two things that I need. One, I need to not ever have to ask for money. I need you to provide the money for the ministry that you're calling forth. And he's been faithful in that, even as he has been with this broadcast. Secondly, I said, Lord, I do not want to pastor a church of women. I want to pastor a church where the majority of those who come are men. Would you send me strong men, men who know how to swing the sword in the spirit, men who know how to stand though the heavens fall, men who have broad vision and generous hearts, not wimpy men, not men who are staked out to the ground by their lust after money and evil, but Lord, send me godly men who know how to stand. And you know what? It's been very rare that there has ever been a prayer meeting or a worship service where the men have not outnumbered the women. I praise God for that. We need a robust, masculine gospel for the day in which we live, not a watered-down, sentimental gospel, not a feminized gospel. We need a manly gospel, and then the women will be attracted to it. They'll want to come because they, too, want something that's real. They want something they can get their teeth into. They want something that answers the cry of their heart. It's very seldom that I meet a woman who wants her husband to be a wimp. What I always hear from women is, if my husband would just stand up and be the spiritual leader of my family. Well, it takes a man to do that. And a woman can't make a boy be a man. A man is a boy who's grown up, who takes responsibility, who understands what life is about, who's willing to pay the price. And Christiana, she reflected on how she had treated her husband and recognized that she had sinned against him. Some of you wives today, you know you're sinning against your husband. You're judging him. You're condemning him. You're saying, if only you'd go make more money. If only you'd work harder. It's time to get right with Jesus. After this, all of her unkind, natural, and ungodly manner toward her dear friend came swarming back into her mind. These things clogged her conscience and loaded her mind with guilt in her heart. Moreover, she was much broken by calling to remembrance the restless groans, the salty tears, the self-lamenting of her husband, how she had hardened her heart against all of his appeals and loving persuasions, both to her and to her sons, to go with him. Yes, there was not anything Christian either said to her or did in front of her, all the while his burden hung on his back, that did not return now upon her like a flash of lightning and tear into the enclosure of her heart. Especially that bitter outcry, "What must I do to be saved?" which rang now most ominously in her ears. Then Christiana said to her children, "Sons, we're all undone. I've sinned away your father, and he's gone. He wanted to have us with him, but I wouldn't go myself. and I hindered you from receiving life. With that, the boys all began weeping and cried out to go after their father. Oh, that it had been our privilege to go with him, exclaimed Christiana. Then it would have fared well with us, better than it is likely now to go. For although I once imagined foolish things about your father's troubles, that they proceeded out of a silly idea that he had, or that he had been overrun with a despondent mood, yet now I can't help but think that they sprang up from another cause, because the light of life was given to him, and by the help of that, as I see, he has now escaped the snares of death. Then they all wept again and cried out, O grief, worth the day! O grief, worth the day! The next night, Christiana had a dream. And in the dream, she saw as it were before her, that there opened a broad parchment roll on which was recorded all of her ways. All of her sins were written down before her. She had to look upon them. The crimes looked very bad for her. And in her sleep, she began to cry out loud, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And the little children heard her. Until you are willing to look honestly at your sin, until you're willing to honestly begin to cry out to God, have mercy on me, a sinner, there's no possibility that you can be saved. If you've never been lost, how can you be saved? One woman said to me, when I listen to your broadcast, Pastor, I get scared. It's so stern. I'm not really that bad. I said, oh, yes, you are. You're much worse than I've been able to describe. And thank you for telling me you're frightened when you listen to the broadcast. I'll try to grow even stronger in my proclamation. For until you become frightened by your sin, until you begin to cry out, God, have mercy on me, a sinner, you have no chance of heaven. Many of you who are listening to this broadcast have done much in the flesh to prepare for heaven. But none of that is going to count in the end. You were able to gussy up the old sin self. You were able to make it go to church, and you were able to get it dressed up, and you were able to make it give some donations and some tithe. You were able to even put down maybe some cussing. You were able to put down maybe even a little bit of lust. I had a young man say to me this last week, Pastor, I'm doing a pretty good job of getting cleaned up. I'm not going to the massage parlors. I'm not going to the prostitutes. Pastor, is God smiling at me now? I had to say, no, he's not smiling at you at all. The wrath of God is still heavy on you. You can't clean up the old nature. You can't clean up the pig. The pig has to go. There has to be a death. There has to be a crucifixion. There has to be a cry emanating out of your soul, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. It was not the Pharisee who went down to his house justified before Jesus. It was the publican who went down justified. Which are you today? Have you been trying to clean up the old man, the old nature? Force it to obey your will and your desire, and part of the time you're able to do it, but now you've taken the position, well, I'm a sinner, I'm always going to be a sinner, I'm just going to trust in the grace of Jesus, I'll tell you what, you'll be disappointed on the great day of judgment because he's not asking you to trust your old nature to the day of judgment. He's asking you to be crucified. He's asking you to turn off everything of darkness and wickedness in your life. He's asking you to come and die on Calvary with him, that you could be resurrected with him, that you could enter into the newness of life and walk holy before him, made righteous, with no longer being at all concerned about what is produced by the flesh, but now it's only that which grows up organically in the work of the Spirit in your life. That's all that counts. The old heart is deceitful and wicked. You have to receive a new heart. You have to be made new into a new creature. And now Christiana comes, and she finally begins to utter these precious words. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Have you said those words? And have you stayed before the Lord until he answered, until his blood washed away your sin? The name Jesus means he saves his people. What does he save them from? He saves them from sin. What does he save them to? He saves them to righteousness. He saves us from sin and to righteousness. He makes us righteous as a free gift of grace. It's not something we do ourselves. It's a gift of God. It's free. But if we haven't received that gift, then we're still walking Christianity, spray painted on the outside, trying to do our best, fooling ourselves and everybody around us that we're Christian, but we never dealt with our sin. My telephone number in the studio is 877-534-0780. I'd love to hear from some of you who are ready to cry out, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. You're ready to let the old nature be crucified. I'd love to hear your cry before God, and I'd love to pray for you. I'd also love to hear from some of you who have made that cry and been delivered from your sin, and you walk in victory now with joy in your heart, a heart of peace, knowing that you're walking in the power of the Spirit, knowing that the Holy Spirit of God is quickening your heart, ordering your steps, directing your path. Our phone number is 877-534-0780. What would you like to do today? Are you ready to make a real choice, make a real decision, a manly choice? You know, I sometimes do altar calls. I never, ever, ever say, would everybody bow their head? And if you'd like to receive Jesus, would you just lift your hand up? No, I don't do that. I say, look, this is public. If you're ashamed of Jesus, don't give your life to him. But if you recognize your sin and you're ready to get right with Jesus, get out of your seat and please come up here now and confess your sins and get right with Jesus. And we'll pray. And we'll begin the process of your praying through to victory and getting washed and made clean by the blood of Jesus. You see, what I'm talking about today is not a private deal. It's public. It's up front. It's not being ashamed of Jesus and the mighty word of his gospel, not being ashamed of his shed blood on Calvary, but standing up and saying, I choose to go on pilgrimage with Jesus. I'm a sinner, and I repent, and I'm going to go the way of the cross. That's what needs to happen. Are you ready? Then call 877-534-0780. I'd like to hear from you. After this cry from Christiana, she thought she saw two very ugly beings standing by her bedside saying, "What shall we do with this woman? She cries out for mercy when awake and asleep. If she's allowed to go on like this, we'll lose her as we lost her husband. Therefore, we must, by one way or another, seek to take her thoughts off what she'll be hereafter, or else all the world won't be able to stop it, and she will become a real pilgrim after Jesus." See, this is the key way of the devil. He wants to raise every obstacle to cause you to say, "I'm afraid. Now's not the time. A more opportune time, I'll turn to Jesus." Many of you turned to Jesus, but it was a phony Jesus. It was a false Jesus. It was a cultural Jesus, dressed up, but not the real deal. I'm looking for people who want the real deal, who don't just want to say a little sinner's prayer. I want people who are willing and ready to repent of their sin, to confess what they've done, to take responsibility for it, to make restitution, to take the blood of Jesus for real and say, "By the blood of Jesus, I am washed and made clean, and I have entered into glory with Jesus, and I'm on that pilgrim journey. This is what my heart hungers for." Does yours? Well, she awoke in a great sweat. Trembling was upon her. But after a while, she fell back to sleep. And then she thought she saw Christian, her husband, in a place of glory among many other sons of Adam, with a harp in his hand, standing and playing upon it before the one who sat on a throne with a rainbow about his head. She also saw, as if he bowed his head with his face to the floor under the prince's feet, saying, "I sincerely thank my Lord and King for bringing me into this place." Then a group of them who stood round about and played their harps shouted, but no man living could tell what they said except Christian and his companions. The next morning when she was up, had prayed to God, had talked with her children a while, someone knocked hard at the door. She called out saying, "If you come in God's name, come in." "Amen," the visitor said. And then he opened the door and greeted her with peace to this house. When he had done this, he said, "Christiana, do you know why I've come?" She blushed and she trembled. Her heart began to feel warm with desire to know where he had come from and what his errand to her was. He said to her, "My name is Secret. I live with those who are high. It is talked of where I live that you have a desire to go there. Also, there is a report that you're aware of the evil you formerly done to your husband in hardening your heart against his way and in keeping your babies in their ignorance." "Christiana," said the visitor, "the merciful one, the Lord has sent me to tell you that he is a God ready to forgive and that he takes delight in multiplying the pardon of offenses. He also wants you to know that he invites you to come into his presence, to his table, and that he will feed you with the fat of his house and with the heritage of Jacob, your father." He continued, "Christian, who was your husband, is there, with thousands more, his companions, ever beholding that face who ministers life to the beholders. And they'll all be glad when they hear the sound of your footstep over your father's threshold. At this, Christiana was greatly comforted in herself and bowed her head to the ground. The visitor proceeded and said, "Christiana, here also is a letter for you that I've brought from your husband's king." She took it and opened it. It smelled of the best perfume and was written in letters of gold. The general content of the letter was that the king wanted her to do as Christian, her husband, had done, for that was the way to come to his city and to dwell in his presence with joy forever. At this, the good woman was quite overcome. So she cried out to her visitor, "Sir, will you take me and my children with you, so that we also may go and worship this king?" And then the visitor said, "Christiana, the bitter comes before the sweet. You must enter the celestial city through troubles, as did he who went before you. For that reason, I advise you to do as Christian, your husband. Go across the plain to the narrow gate over there, for it stands at the head of the way up which you must go, and I wish you good speed. Also, I advise you to put this letter next to your heart in your coat, so you can read out of it to yourself and to your children until you've memorized it, for it's one of the songs you must sing while you're in the house of your pilgrimage. Also, you must deliver it at the gate at the end of your journey." Did you know there's a letter inviting you to come? You can read that letter in 1 John. You can read that letter in the Gospel of John. You're invited to go to the celestial city. But you're going to have to leave behind your life, your friends. All that you've produced in the flesh is going to have to go to the cross. And only that which of the Spirit will remain. You're going to have to go through that narrow gate. And nothing of the flesh will fit through that narrow gate. It's too narrow a gate. Only that which is of the Spirit will fit through that gate. And then there's the cross. And the burden of sin will be removed from your heart. And it will roll away from you, and it will end up in that empty tomb. Your sin will all be forgiven by the blood shed on Calvary. As you look up at that cross, you'll see the crucified Lord. And then you'll see the risen Lord as he sits at the right hand of the Father. You've been invited to come on this pilgrimage. Will you take the invitation seriously? Will you take up the journey of the cross? Some of you know so much about the Christian faith. You can quote scriptures. You can speak eloquently about the scriptures. You can argue with the very best. But you know your life is filled with the things of this world. You know that you've never really taken up your cross. It's time. Will you take up your cross today? Will you nurture in the Spirit the conviction of the Holy Spirit? You see, the Holy Spirit will come and he'll begin to bring those first tiny waves of conviction to your heart. You'll say, "I want to follow Jesus. I want something deeper. I want something real. I'm tired of the faults." That's the Holy Spirit. He's beginning to move in your heart. As you nurture that, as you take those steps that he's calling you, those baby steps, you'll get into deeper water. Until finally you'll begin to recognize the utter wretchedness of your soul. Remember the message to the church at Laodicea: wretched, poor, miserable, blind, naked, and they didn't know it. And the reason they didn't know it was that they rejected all of the convictions of the Holy Spirit. They refused to acknowledge the Holy Spirit's work in convicting them of their sin. They said, "Oh, I'm saved. I repented when I was born again. I don't need to repent now. I'm covered by the blood. When Jesus looks at me, he doesn't see me, he sees Jesus." And so the Kool-Aid is taken. The drugs are taken of the world in the Christian guise. And men and women march off saying, "I'm a wonderful Christian," on their way to hell. Will you nurture those beginning waves of conviction that even during this broadcast have begun to flow into your heart? The questioning, am I really saved? Am I really praying the way I need to pray? Am I really reading the scripture the way I need to read it? When was the last time you spent a day fasting? When was the last time you spent a night praying, weeping before God? No, most of you have not done these things because Christianity for you is very casual and very intellectual, and it's about doing things and social activities and going here and going there. It's time to get quiet before God. It's time to take time to be holy. I'm going to ask our producer to play that song again for us. Take time to be holy.
Friends of God.
I'm Ray Greenlee, pastor of the National Prayer Chapel. You've been listening to Pilgrim's Progress. I'll talk with you tomorrow. God bless you.
To keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of His glory with great joy, with great joy. Now unto Him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of His glory.